Hello friends, welcome to PMFIS YouTube channel. In this video, we'll be discussing prelims questions from 2021 from subjects Geography, Environment, Science and Tech, and Agriculture. These are the subjects that we cover on PMFIS.com. We'll also be explaining you the solutions and also telling you how useful was PMFIS content while dealing with these questions. This is a multi-part video series. In the first video, we'll be discussing questions from geography and agriculture. Coming to the first question, leaf litter decomposes faster than in any other biome, and as a result, the soil surface is almost bare. Apart from trees, the vegetation is largely composed of plant forms that reach up into the canopy vicariously by climbing the trees or growing as epiphytes. This question is one of the easiest questions. It offers a lot of clues like epiphytes, canopy, which are a distinct feature of tropical rainforests. Coming to the leaf litter decomposes faster, this particular sentence is also very much relevant to tropical rainforests because tropical rainforests have very high levels of humidity and temperature, which is ideal for the decomposition of any kind of organic matter. On the other hand, we have coniferous forests, which have very low temperature. As a result, the litter doesn't decompose quickly. And in the dry deciduous forest, there is a distinct dry and wet season. In the dry season, the dry litter doesn't decompose because of lack of humidity. And in the mangrove forest, we don't have a subsoil surface really because the mangrove forests lie in the intertidal zone. So we have mentioned this in both our geography and environment notes. The concept of epiphytes canopy can be found on page number 77 of the newly launched environment hard copy. Coming to the next question, the vegetation of savanna consists of grassland with scattered small trees, but extensive area have no trees. The forest development in such areas is generally kept in check by one or more or a combination of some conditions. We know that savanna is a climatic condition with a distinct dry and wet season. Summers are wet, whereas the winters are dry. In the wet season, there is luxuriant vegetation, whereas in the dry season, the grasses are very dry and there is significant amount of dead dry leaves on the surface. As a result, the conditions are ideal for forest fires. So the seasonal rainfall is the reason behind the forest fires, and the forest fires are bad for seeds and small saplings. So the answer for this question is 2, 3 and 4. And since the savanna climatic condition is dominated by the movement of intertropical convergence zone, there is an alternate wet and dry conditions in the region. This creates to a great migration where animals migrate from north to south and south to north based on the season. So this great migration gives rise to large movement of animals which trample the saplings which come out of the seeds. As a result, this is another major factor why the savanna regions doesn't have a significant density of trees. Consider the following rivers: Brahmani, Nagalvani, Subarnarekha and Vamshadhara. Vamshadhara is the river which is in news because the waters of this river is disputed between Orissa and Andhra Pradesh. Coming to the easiest of the options, I would consider Brahmani as the easiest option because Brahmani and Baitarani are the rivers which combine and flow through this particular region where we have Bhitarkanika, mangroves and wildlife sanctuary. Brahmani is constantly in news, and in the PMFIS notes we have mentioned that Subarnarekha rises in the Ranchi Plateau and Brahmani River rises near Rourkela, which is in Orissa. So the answer for this, if we just eliminate Brahmani and Subarnarekha, that is 1 and 3. So 1, 3. So the answer would be 2 and 4. So it would be hard to remember such a minute rivers like Nagalvani or any other rivers that are flowing from the Eastern Ghats or the Western Ghats. But still, using the smart elimination method, you can easily find out the answer. Consider the following statements. So this particular topic has been mentioned several times in the PMFIS current affairs as well as in the geography notes. So the Global Ocean Commission is not the right agency. It's actually International Seabed Authority which grants licenses. So this option is wrong. India has received license for seabed mineral exploration. Yes. In the Central Indian Ocean Basin, International Seabed Authority has given India permission to explore the deep ocean minerals. And coming to the rare earth minerals, these are polymetallic nodules which are available at the seafloor. Along with that, there would be some other minerals which are rarely occur on the Earth's surface. This should not be confused with rare earth metals, because the rare earth metals is a slightly different kind of a concept which is given in our current affairs. So again, rare earth metals are present on the seafloor in international waters is a right option. Coming to the answer, 2 and 3 is the correct option. This is mentioned several times in our PMFIS geography notes as well as the current affairs. Consider the following statements. In the intertropical zone, the western sections of the oceans are warmer than the eastern sections owing to the influence of trade winds. So this option is correct, because we know that the trade winds are easterlies, that is, they flow from east to west. As a result, the water from the eastern sections of the oceans are pulled towards the western sections. This is what the first point says. In the temperate zone, westerlies make the eastern sections of the oceans warmer than the western sections. Let's understand this with the help of a map of ocean currents. Here we know that north equatorial currents in the northern hemisphere is influenced by the easterlies or the trade winds. All the warm water is dragged towards the western part of the ocean. As a result, there is an upwelling in the eastern parts. Here, the warm current flows towards north, and under the influence of westerlies, they flow from west to east, bringing warm waters from the western side to eastern side. Now, let us look at the temperature profile. Here, the westerlies are dragging the warm waters towards the east. Still, the western oceans are at higher temperature compared to the eastern part of the ocean. If you look at the question, it says, in the temperate zone, westerlies make the eastern sections of the oceans warmer than the western sections. We know that the trade winds drag the water from east to west of the western part of the ocean. As a result, the western part is much warmer. And these currents move towards north, and under the influence of westerlies, they flow from west to east. So we have North Atlantic Drift. And this particular current is mixed with the Labrador Current, which is a cold current. As a result, the warmness of the ocean current decreases as it moves from west to east. So this point is wrong. The answer for this question is one only. Coming to the next question, the black cotton soil of India has been formed due to the weathering off. And this is another easy question. The black cotton soil is also known as regur, R-E-G-U-R. It is the typical feature of the northwestern side of the peninsula latitude. This is where the Deccan traps are. The Deccan traps were formed due to flood basalt volcanism, which is also known as fissure volcanism. Here we have a large fissure through which significant amount of basaltic magma flows out. And these rocks are the reason behind the black cotton soil that exists in this Deccan Traps region. Another similar landform to Deccan Traps is Siberian Traps. It is also a result of fissure volcanism. So the answer is pretty straightforward, and it is covered in our PMFIS Indian Geography notes. Coming to the next question, with reference to India, Didwana, Kuchaman, Sargol and Katu are the names of. Let's first look at the easiest of the options. Let us consider the mangrove areas. We know that in Tamil Nadu, Pichavaram is an important mangrove site. In Maharashtra, Ratnagiri is an important mangrove site. In Andhra Pradesh, Koringa is an important mangrove site. So if you consider, there are only about 7 to 8 important mangrove sites, and none of them has any of these particular names. So this option can be discarded. The next easiest option is Ramsar sites. There are 46 Ramsar sites as of today, and none of these come close to the names of Ramsar sites. So even this option can be discarded. And we would be stuck between glaciers and saline lakes. So unless you know exactly particular lakes, it would be risky to answer this question. In the PMFIS Indian Geography section, under Indo-Gangetic Brahmaputra Plain, under the Rajasthan Plain, we have mentioned the lakes, the saline lakes in the region near the Luni River. So here we have mentioned the terms Didwana as well as Kuchaman. This is a tough question, but still, if you have gone through the content, maybe you would have found the clues to get the answer, saline lakes. With reference to Indus River system, of the following 4 rivers, 3 of them pour into one of them which joins the Indus direct. Among the following, which is such river that joins the Indus direct? Let's look at the map. Sutlej is the longest tributary of Indus. Sutlej and Chenab combine and form Panjnath. This is what actually is mentioned in all the books. We don't have a proper clue whether exactly the Chenab or Sutlej can be considered as the major tributary of Indus. But let's look at the question, which offers some clue. Here it says 3 of them pour into one of them. So from the map, it is clear that Jhelum and Ravi flow into Chenab, whereas only the Bias flows into Satluj. It's fair to say that Satluj flows into Chenab other than Chenab flows into Satluj. So we would consider the answer for this question as Chenab. But again, it's debatable. Coming to the next question, with reference to water on the planet Earth, consider the following statements. So this particular table in NCERT, which is also given in PMFIS notes, based on this important table, there are 2 to 3 questions which were asked in the previous prelims as well. From the table, it's very clear that the water in ice caps and glaciers is far higher compared to the water in rivers and lakes or the groundwater. So the first point is false. So the answer is B, 2 only. In the PMFIS, we have given a clear table. So from geography section, we were able to manage 9 out of 9 questions from PMFIS notes. Now let's move on to agriculture questions asked in UPSC prelims 2021. Coming to the first question on agriculture, among the following, which one is the least water efficient crop? We know that paddy, sugarcane are water intensive crops and millets are the most water efficient crops. This particular information can be gathered from PMFIS major crops notes, where we have discussed the influence of rainfall on various crops. If you consider the most water efficient among these options, we can consider millets as the most water efficient, followed by pulses, followed by oil seeds, and the least water efficient is sugarcane. Bowl gourd 1 and bowl gourd 2 technologies are mentioned in the context of. In our current affairs, we have mentioned this several times. So bowl gourd 1 and 2 are GM cotton seeds. So the answer for this is genetically modified crop plants. So in the PMFIS current affairs, we have mentioned this several times. Coming to the next question, this is one of the most unconventional questions asked in UPSC prelims. We would not know these many details about something as insignificant as a drumstick tree. But still, let us look at the options. It mentions that moringa or drumstick tree is a leguminous evergreen tree. If you look around peninsular India and in the plains region, the drumstick tree would be a common sight. From this, applying our common sense, we can say that it's not an evergreen tree because these regions do not support evergreen vegetation. These regions are dominated by deciduous tree varieties. And coming to tamarind tree is endemic to South Asia. Again, this point, we may not be having a clue on this. Coming to the third point, in India, most of the tamarind is collected as minor forest produce. So if you have ever seen a tamarind tree, it is not grown as a plantation. They are available in random locations and most of the tamarind is collected as a minor forest produce. If you apply some common sense, we can arrive at a conclusion that this point is correct. But again, the next two points are very much not from the conventional sources. India exports tamarind and seeds of moringa. It's really hard to say whether this statement is correct or wrong without a concrete evidence. Seeds of moringa and tamarind can be used in production of biofuels. Again, the national biofuel policy doesn't specifically mention moringa or tamarind, so it's really hard again to conclude whether this statement is correct or wrong. But if you use the elimination method and if you are sure about point 1, then you are left with the option B, 3, 4 and 5. So this is a question where it looks tough, but if you use smart elimination, it is easy to arrive at the answer. How is permaculture farming different from conventional chemical farming? So the questions on sustainable agriculture have been coming repetitively, but for some reason we have missed the term permaculture in our notes. Permaculture is a sustainable agricultural practice which emphasizes on natural methods of farming. So if you consider all these options, permaculture farming discourages monocultural practices, but in conventional farming, monocultural practices are predominant. Yeah, this point is true. Conventional chemical farming can cause increase in soil salinity, but occurrence of such phenomenon is not observed in permaculture farming because permaculture farming is a sustainable method. It doesn't involve creating these kind of issues. Conventional chemical farming is easily possible in semi-arid regions. This particular statement is wrong because conventional chemical farming depends heavily on irrigation and chemical fertilizers, and in the semi-arid regions, it is very hard to provide irrigational facilities. So this particular sentence is wrong. Mulching is sometimes followed in conventional chemical farming, but it's not the most crucial practice in the conventional chemical farming because here we have irrigation, utilization of fertilizers and mechanization of agriculture. These are the kind of things which are very much useful for conventional chemical farming. So this point is also right. Except 3, all other options are correct. So the answer is B. It has been in news in the Hindu Business Line, which is not a very familiar source when it comes to UPSC preparation. So I would call this question a somewhat unconventional in nature. Coming to the next question, with reference to palm oil, consider the following statements. Palm oil is native to Southeast Asia. It is used in lipstick and perfumes. It can be used to produce biodiesel. We have covered extensively biofuels, where there is a clear mention of biodiesel can be produced from vegetable oils. And in the National Biofuel Policy, it says biodiesel can be produced from edible vegetable oil. The palm falls under non-edible vegetable oils. Hence, it can be used in production of biodiesel. So this point is correct. We can eliminate point A from this. Coming to the other two points, it would be hard to say whether this statement 2 is true or false. But in several of our notes, we have mentioned about whether palm oil is native to Southeast Asia or some other region. So in one of the statements, we have mentioned that cocoa is important crop in West Africa. There we have also mentioned that from the same region, another crop, oil palm, has been done equally well in the Southeast Asian countries like Indonesia and Malaysia. So from this, we can get the clue that palm oil is not native to Southeast Asia. It is native to Western Africa. This point is wrong. There shouldn't be one in the answer. The only such option is B. So I would say this is a question of medium difficulty and can be managed. Coming to the performance of PMFIS in dealing with geography and agriculture questions, we would say in terms of geography, we have done a good job. 9 out of 9 questions can be answered from PMFIS content. In agriculture, 2 of the questions we have not covered. One is permaculture, which should have been there in the current affairs, but we have not covered that. Next video, we'll be discussing questions from environment. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to subscribe. We'll be soon launching environment video course based on PMFIS environment hard copy. Stay subscribed to our Telegram channel. This is where we keep posting about the updates of the video course. Thank you.